My name is Ilan Pappé. I'm a professor of history at the University of Exeter. I'm the director of the European Center for Palestine Studies. I was born in Haifa in Israel and lived part of my life there. Became an academic in Israel, and then due to my research, my views, my positions, I had to leave in 2006. And I joined the University of Exeter. And I'm a historian who wrote quite extensively on the history of Palestine in general and the history of 1948 in particular. I think it's the worst chapter in the history of Palestine, both in the period I lived already through, but also the historical periods I researched, because I didn't live through the Nakba, but I'm very much aware of what happened in the Nakba, and I think this is worse. So it's very, very difficult, depressing, and outraging to live through a genocide at the time that it's so transparent, so visible, and so little is being done. So on a certain level, this is the most depressing moment, personally I'm speaking, depressing moment in the history of Palestine. But as always, maybe we'll talk about it. We're definitely going to talk about it in this event. We also have to look for the positive things that we can take out of it and not to lose hope. But it's a very difficult time. Yeah. I think the long term, not so much the short term, unfortunately, but I think the long term indicates that the basic moral, even I would say economic and military infrastructure that holds together the state of Israel and allows it to oppress the Palestinians is being eroded, has been eroded very significantly. And this is going to continue in the future. And there are all kinds of transformation in world public opinion, in the position of governments in the global south, that among the Jewish communities, that indicate that there is a good possibility for an alliance that would be more effective than in the past in helping the Palestinians to obtain their goals of liberation, of decolonization, and survival. And I think this is something we should keep in mind because we unfortunately we're into 2 or 3 years where not many positive things would unfold. But we'll have to remind ourselves that life does not end in the next 2 years, that there is another a longer period into which we should look into the future. I think in general the assumption that if you want to wait for a change inside the Israeli Jewish society as the best way of changing the reality on the ground, I think this assumption is still invalid as it was before. Namely, I don't expect any significant change within the Israeli Jewish society. And the way it is composed today, ideologically, socially, culturally, and economically, it doesn't seem to offer us any hope for the future if we just focus on that society. In the main, it is a society that became, even before the 7th of October, more extreme, more racist, more unable to accept the humanization or the humanity of the Palestinians, and not very prone to any criticism from the outside. Now, On the other hand, I would say that despite that fact, as you mentioned correctly, there is a small civil war going on. It was there before the 7th of October, probably would be renewed, between more secular Israelis who think that they can create a democracy that would be pluralistic, open-minded, despite the fact that they have no objection to continue the occupation or the discrimination of the Palestinian citizens of Israel. That's one group. And then there is the group that grew up in the Jewish settlements in the West Bank that want to turn Israel into a more theocratic state, a far more extreme messianic state, I would say even, namely totally immune from any pressure from the outside because God is with them. And this kind of idea of messianic Zionist ideology, which was one on the margins of Israeli Jewish society, is now very much at the center. And I don't think that the events of the 7th of October are going to, at least in the short run, are not going to weaken this tendency within the Jewish society to become, even in Israeli terms, more right-wing. Maybe in the long run, people would reconsider whether force has, or whether military power is enough to keep Israel together, whether military power is providing the security that Israel claims it offers Jews all over the world. But in the short run, it doesn't seem so. So if we talk about the Israeli Jewish society, we have these two clear sections. For better, for worse, for better terms, we'll call it the secular and the religious, but these are a little bit misleading adjectives, but we don't have better ones. So I call it the State of Israel and the State of Judea. State of Judea is one of the settlers. So the settler state and the State of Tel Aviv, there are various ways of epitomizing these two camps in Israel. As you said, what is very important to understand, the Palestinians are not very relevant for that debate. The debate is mainly because the idea of creating a state on the basis of a Jewish religion is not working. The fact that people see themselves as Jews is not enough to create a national identity. This is nothing to do with the Palestinians. Namely, I think that even if the Zionist movement would have taken an empty island in the ocean, it wouldn't work. Of course, the fact that this is done by creating the only unity between all these different Jewish groups through a common enemy, through a sense of lack of security, makes it even worse. So at least in the theoretic case of living in an island, they wouldn't harm anyone apart from themselves. In the situation in Palestine, the failure has collateral damage that is beyond themselves. But it's not working. It is not working. This is, you know, coupled with a serious economic crisis and lack of international legitimacy in many parts of the world. First of all, they don't want to see. So it's not just if the media would have shown them pictures of dead children in Gaza, the destruction in Gaza, they would turn off the television. They won't watch. And the media knows it. So it's not just what Gideon says, that the media chooses to censor. The media knows what its audience wants. Secondly, don't forget that in this particular case, but this is not true for the whole history of Israel, this particular case, there's also a sense of revenge. And revenge blinds people, we know that. Revenge, I mean, for what happened on 7th of October. Now it's beyond revenge. Now it's back to the old racism of dehumanization of the Palestinians. But you have to understand that you're talking here of a very indoctrinated society. that truth is all the time manipulated for them, is filtered for them. In a way, and the most important part of it is the dehumanization of the Palestinians. Namely, you either associate the Palestinians with the Nazis, and then you don't feel sorry for what's being done to them. Or you associate them with the Islamic State, and then you don't feel sorry for what's happening to them. Or you sort of claim that it's a hopeless, savage society. So yes, you may feel a bit sorry about what's happening to the kids, but do remember, you know, these kids can only grow up to be, you know, the monsters that we say that they are. This is ingrained within the Israeli educational system, the media, and so on. The total defamation, demonization is a better word. There's a total demonization of the Palestinians from the very beginning of the State of Israel. And you can see it in the educational system, you can see it in the media, you can see it even in the academia. And you know, after 75 years of indoctrination, the youngest generation is already living within that mindset. And that is a mindset which is very, very difficult to challenge. Well, I'm afraid that we are into another year at least of the same in Gaza. I don't think the international community has the power to stop Israel. I don't think everything would be exactly as it had been in the last 3 months. Namely, we will see different kinds of military operations. For the local Palestinians in Gaza, it doesn't matter. It means the prolonging of their suffering, either as refugees, as wounded people, or as people who lost whole families. I think this terrible reality can unfortunately go on for a while because the international community that has the power to stop Israel is not going to do it. The big enigma here is how would the Palestinians in the West Bank react to this? I don't think we should judge the reaction by what they have done or haven't done in the last 3 months. We should ask ourselves what happens if they see it continuing. It's very difficult to say, but probably there is a third uprising on the way in the West Bank. What would the Hezbollah's reaction in the North be? So far it's been very tamed, very restricted. Hezbollah refused to coordinate the attack on the 7th of October. It does detract Israeli forces in a kind of a small attrition war in the north, but it's not the same of what it has the potential of doing. Will it escalate to a regional war? You know, even if nobody wants a regional war, it's very easy to deteriorate into a regional war. So we have a lot of unknown factors, but I think we have to embrace ourselves. And for us, it's easy to say it in London. I think most importantly, the people of Gaza are at least in the short run, are going to live in this unbearable situation. I do think that in a bit of a longer run, more positive things will happen. I think that the Zionist project is beginning to dismantle, to disintegrate. I think the international community would move to sanctions. I think the Arab world would go through transformation that would also change its policies towards the Palestine issue. I think some of the great big Muslim countries will also become a bit more proactive than they are. So I do think that there is a hope for a very different alliance facing Israel not in the immediate future, but in the nearer future, that would have the power to at least stop some of the suffering, some of the killing, some of the demolition. It would not yet decolonize Palestine, but it might create the conducive circumstances for the next stages that we are all waiting, not all, we are waiting for. No, I think they are significant. I don't think they have the power to stop Israel. I think they're very important. I think it's very important to bring Israel to the court for the first time. I think that they are landmarks or stations in a very important trajectory, so they will add to the pressure. I don't think they have the potential of doing it themselves. I think they're part of a trend which is very positive and very important. But anyone who thinks that these kinds of legalities have the power to stop a racist state that believes that anyway any international tribunal is anti-Semitic, and what matters is what is being decided in Washington, not in The Hague, would be taken by surprise, even if the ICJ rules against it. It doesn't understand how the Israelis work. And they always work in the same, even if the Americans would feel a bit uncomfortable about the ICJ, they would have to, the Israelis would have a way of saying, okay, we are reducing the military actions, but, you know, they promised the Americans hundreds of times to stop the settlements in the West Bank, and they didn't do it. So I'm afraid that if you are faced with a regime that is determined to destroy the native people, you need far tougher action than just a ruling of an International Court of Justice. No, unfortunately, I wasn't surprised. I think that people underestimate the fact that all the lobbies that work in America, not all of them are Jewish, by the way. A very important lobby in America is the Christian lobby, Christian Zionist lobby. Another important lobby in America is the military industrial lobby. All the lobbies that work for Israel have been doing it from the very first day of the state. Namely, they are in action for 75 years. Many of them were actually already active on behalf of Zionism before the establishment of the State of Israel. When you have such a longevity of lobbying, it works by inertia. Namely, Biden knows what he has to do without even one phone call from an Israeli ambassador or a lobbyist of AIPAC. That's part of the DNA of American politics, is to make sure that you satisfy the pro-Israeli lobby. I think they're misreading the fundamental shifts in the public opinion. I think that it's very difficult to gauge public opinion in America because of the electoral system. You may have a total shift towards Palestine in California and New York, but then small countries in the Midwest would give Trump the victory because of the way the system works. They're in a rabbit hole when they think about politics. I think they're misreading it. I'm very optimistic about it because of that. I think the people who are marching today in New York are the people who might be the senators and House representatives of the House in the future. And I don't think they will change fundamentally because of power. I think there is a younger generation that is immune to that lobby. So we need to be patient. Biden is 80 years old or 82 years old. His generation is not going to change. The generation of politicians in America who are in the 50s and the 60s are also not so likely. We have to pay attention to those in the 20s and the 30s, what happens to them when they come into the system. I think they're much more connected with public opinion. I think also the moral value system would work in favor of Palestine and would shift them away from Israel. I agree, people forget that Zionism was an evangelical Christian project before it was a Jewish one. So it's very much an important part of the lobbying and the strengths. And yes, we have to confront it. That's one side of the story On the other hand, because Israel is losing the Jewish community in America, it will only rely eventually on the Christian Zionists. It's not the strongest moral basis for the state. So yes, we have to focus on it. We have to talk about it. We have to make sure that the Islamophobia that tends to focus on fundamentalism or extreme position that exists in every religion somehow are confined to analysis of Islam. You never hear it about Hinduism, Judaism, or Christianity. Of course, we have to change that conversation very quickly because to identify really the forces that are destroying our world. But I do think that this would happen anyway, I think. There's something about the Christian Zionists that will not hold water, I think, in the future. But they are powerful. Right now, they're very powerful. I think it would be written as the beginning of the end of the Zionist project. And people who are good historians would remind the readers that the beginning of an end of projects such as Zionism is the most dangerous chapter in the history of a place. It's when the regime, the project, call it what you want, fights for its existence. And then it is very cruel, it's ruthless, it's very violent, more than it ever has been. So people would say this was the darkest moment probably in the history of Palestine, but it was the darkness before the dawn. I think that's what people would call it. And I think that they would look at it and would say, yes, these were terrible years, but they led to something much better that we never thought would happen, but probably will happen. What is really positive about the younger generation is it's, on the case of Palestine compared to our and previous generation, they are far more consensual. I think they speak the same language. I think the internet helped to create a community that is so large and so widespread, talking the same languages, bringing back moral values, understanding each other, even able to coexist with different ideas and backgrounds. So that's a positive thing. I have nothing to advise there. I think what is missing is a realization that comes a bit later that this is not enough, that you need an organization. You need an organization, you need a structure, not a hierarchy. I understand young people are very worried about hierarchies, but you need a structure, you need an organization to carry out this positive energy. In the case of Palestine, I can be even more specific. I think the younger generation should begin to think about a strategy that is beyond sound bites of Palestine free from the river to the sea, and all, which I totally share, but to build content to this. What does it mean? What do you suggest for the Jews who live now in Israel? How do you see them in a future Palestine? How do you see future Palestine in the relationship between Christians and Muslims, the various ideas of Islam and so on, and begin to fill this idea of a state that maybe it's not even a state, it's another project, which I think we all understand is trying to avoid the pitfalls of the past in the Arab world. It doesn't want to be a Western state that totally failed in the Arab world. The idea of having a Western state in the Arab world is not working. They don't want to be the Arab states of today. There's a lot of problem with the Arab states of today. So it's obvious that we are built there. This young generation will have to build something that is new, that lies, that connects to the tradition, to the legacies of the area, not going to a supermarket outside of the region. But we need to begin to see some concrete ideas. I think that would really, really help people to understand what they're fighting for beyond a very strong and very blessed sense of justice.